Today's featured book is the story of a slave using his gift to speak truth to power and liberate himself. It'll give you a new perspective on the fables you've heard your whole life.
You know, there's a ton of Aesop's books out there. In the intro, a lot of times, if there's any intro, they'll give a brief mention, like kind of like a one-liner of, and Aesop is rumored to have been a slave who was a master storyteller whose stories were so good that he was freed. And it, like, if you're a writer and you read that, first of all, if you're a kid's book writer, this instantly in my brain, I just went, well, that's a story, and that's an amazing story. And, you know, I thought I was a genius because I was, oh my God, I've discovered this story and no one's ever heard of it before. And then I start researching it. It turns out I'm not a genius. This is one of the oldest stories in civilization. It's one of the most popular stories in human civilization. Like, I'm not the first to step onto this boat. You know what I mean? And that became even more fascinating for me because, A, what kind of story has that staying power? You know, there's something very powerful in this kind of story. And B, why have we lost that? Why is it just one sentence in an introduction to fables? It seems like it's something much more important. And so as I did my research, I realized, oh yeah, there's a lot there. It's the life of Aesop. It's a key that unlocks all these fables and kind of tells you what's going on behind the curtain, you know?
So why do you think it was lost? Why do you think it's not a story that, along with the others, gets retold and retold in recent past?
You know, I don't know why it's faded away quite as much. I mean, again, it's sort of the fables and the life of Aesop. So when the fables were first recorded in sort of like, first century BC and later in the first century CE, it was always couched with the life of Aesop. They were always recorded together. It was seen as a continuous part of those stories to have the life of Aesop with them. And then the actual fables themselves became so widely disseminated and part of our culture that, you know, you get all these reprints, you know, every great illustrator ends up taking a swing at them at some point. And I think at some point, again, I'm not blaming the Victorians, there's nothing wrong with what they did, but they sort of turned fables, which were never originally intended for children, around the 17th century in Europe, there was a move towards these are stories to educate kids about being morally upright. And that progressively got stronger and stronger in the sentiment around these. And again, these were normally stories reserved for grown-ups, adults, politicians, that sort of thing. And the Victorians really codified that so that, you know, the idea of a childhood, the Victorians kind of invented the concept of children are different. Children have a childhood and it's an innocent place where no snake ever enters that garden. And these fables are part of that story. And the life of Aesop, which is about a man who was enslaved, a man who's kept down, that doesn't neatly fit into that narrative. And so I think on no conscious part of anyone's, I don't think anyone ever said, we shall never read this book again. It just kind of got divorced from the fables themselves. And that split has slowly been pulling apart. And that's why I want to bring it back together, because it's such an important part of this storytelling format, this method.